Our scripture reading today comes from Exodus chapter 20. It's page 116 in the Red Bibles. We're going to read verses 1 through 17. This is what God's word says. And God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above, or on earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, and showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, nor your male or female servant, nor your animals, nor any foreigner residing in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, and he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not give false testimony against your neighbor, you shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male or female servant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Our series entitled Rehab has been talking about what it's like for us to engage in repentance, in some self-examination, to consider how we might need to rehab our lives in these days of Lent as we journey towards the cross. Now, in any rehab program, there's always a program, whether it's an alcoholic going through AA or somebody who's addicted to drugs going through the NA program. Weight Watchers is a program for addicts. My wife reminds me regularly, these people are food addicts. Girl, you don't get how that works. Yeah, I'm not a food addict. I like food, don't get me wrong, but I make her crazy because I can have a package of cookies and it'll last me a week. She's like, you're definitely not a food addict. That would have to be gone today. But anyway, they have a program involving points and portion control. Some people have to go through a rehab program for cardiac issues. And that involves diet and exercise. My mother-in-law went home yesterday with a low-sodium, heart-healthy diet. She is not excited at all. She went to hot dog first thing. Her husband said, no, it's not low-sodium. She wasn't happy. So in any rehab program, there's this protocol you're supposed to follow. And there's often a coach or a sponsor, somebody who's going to journey with you and help you through that program. Now, the point of these programs is that you'll have added success. You can say, okay, just stop drinking. That's very successful. But when you engage someone with a sponsor and you help them to walk the 12-step program of AA, they have amazing success. It's one thing to say, well, just lose weight. My wife said she was going to join Weight Watchers back right after Toby was born, or right after Noah was born. She said, but I'm not going to do those meetings. I just want to. She went to a meeting and she came home. She went back the next week. She came home and she went back the third week. I said, I thought you weren't doing a meeting. She said, the meetings are where it's at. I have people there that walk me through the program. And that's the way I'm going to succeed. Okay. When she finally hit goal, she said, I think I'm going to work for these guys part-time so I can keep the weight off. Because if I try to do this on my own, this won't go well. She understood the importance of having a coach to help her stick to the program. Most of us, if we have heart issues, It's one thing to say eat better. It's another thing to have someone help you to understand what a heart-healthy diet is and to hold you accountable what you're eating. All those programs are designed to give you greater success, wholeness of life, healthier approach. How wonderful it is to watch someone who has been addicted to alcohol for years to begin to count months and then years of sobriety, years of healthier living, years of better relationships. That's what a rehab program is about. It's about getting someone on a track, on a program, so that they have a better outcome in life. In Christianity, we have a program. It's not a program for salvation. The point of salvation is, hey, you're loved by God. You're saved by grace. You couldn't do anything about that. Either you accept His grace or it's not going to work. But the program is about how to draw closer to God. And the program starts with these Ten Commandments. Now, I don't know about you, Ten Commandments seem pretty Old Testament. We don't talk about them much in Christianity. Yeah, the Jews dealt with those. Moses brought them off the mountain. It's a good idea that the Jews had them, but a little too legalistic for most of us Methodists, so we leave them alone. If you've ever had a chance to study the Ten Commandments, you know that in the Ten Commandments is an ability to touch almost every single area of your life. They're not stale 10 suggestions you keep if you want, you don't want to keep, it's not a big deal. In the Ten Commandments is the opportunity to touch every area of life. Last week, when Frank and Mary and Sharon and I were at the marriage retreat, they had us all stand up and they started the Ten Commandments and they said, okay, sit down if you've broken the first commandment to know God before God. Most people sat down. They went on, they only got to about commandment 3 and everybody was sitting. And he says, if I had time to unpack the first commandment, you'd all be sitting on the first commandment. And he's right. When in life have you put something before God? Your spouse, your job, your hobby, your children, your vacation, your goals. Well, most of us can think back over the last 7 days and find even more than one experience in the last 7 days where we put something before God, thereby breaking it. And it just gets more difficult as you walk through those Ten Commandments. Remember, Jesus said, it's not just about did I kill somebody lately, but what have your words done? He says in Matthew, the commandment is don't murder, but I would say to you, don't even speak angrily to someone, because in doing that, you're murdering them emotionally. Don't do that. So when we begin to unpack these Ten Commandments, we find that they squirt off into every direction of life, and there's no part of life that is not linked with one of these Ten Commandments. The first 4 are about our walk with God. The final 6 are about our relationship with each other. It touches everything. And this program in Christianity is not about salvation. It's about getting closer to God. Have you spent time thinking about that? You see, we love to say we're saved by grace. And sometimes we like that so much that what we really mean is, I'm saved by grace, therefore I don't have to do anything. I can live whatever I want. That's not the program. The program is not accept God's grace and live how you want. The program is be saved by God's grace, now begin to work on your life with this program, that you look more like Christ. You're drawn more into His presence. That you're back in the relationship with Him, and with fellow humanity that God designed you to be. I've often joked that ministry would be so much easier if it didn't involve dealing with people. Just think how much easier ministry would be without people, right? Think how much easier your life would be if you didn't have to deal with people. Even the ones that you really like can be difficult some days, right? And that's because of sin. The reality is that you and I are strapped with this burden called a sinful nature, and it affects everything we do. How we worship God, how we honor the Sabbath, how we relate to one another, how we love our family members. This sin is a thorny problem. The Ten Commandments, this program, is about putting ourselves under the authority of God. I
and striving for obedience.
Obedience is not a suggestion. It's a command. God doesn't say, try not to kill anyone. Try not to commit adultery. Try not to lie. Hear what it said. Do not. There's not a lot of wiggle room.
Reality is, again, if I say to you, just don't break any of that Ten Commandments, you'll leave here and you might make it all the way to your car without breaking one. I might make it all the way to the Euclid Avenue door on my way home.
But this program is designed to be worked with a coach.
You have coaches at a variety of levels. You have mentors at a variety of levels. You have sponsors, if you will, at a variety of levels. At the most practical level, you have fellow brothers and sisters in Christ who are willing to journey with you. That's why it's a small groups is about, folks. Small groups is an opportunity to get in community with a handful of people and do life together. Doesn't happen overnight. You stick in there for 6 weeks and you'll find yourself amazingly drawn to these people and connected with these people. At another level, you have friends. You have myself. You have staff here at the church that are there to help us as we wrestle with this program of obedience to God. They're probably most important and most effective. What you have is the Holy Spirit. The one who not only directs you as to what obedience looks like, but the one who empowers your ability to obey. You know, sometimes people enter a cardiac rehab program, they're in a weakened condition, and they look at what they want them to do, and they say, there is no way I can do this and still live. This is going to kill me. But if they will trust that the coach who is walking them through that program knows what they're doing, they will not only survive, they will thrive. When you look at the diet prescriptions, you think, as my mother-in-law said, that's all the taste and everything. Nothing's going to taste good. My mother-in-law likes food and then salt on top of whatever she's eating. And that's not going to be good. She is sure she is never going to put a piece of food in her mouth again and she's going to like it. It's going to be hard for her to change her eating habits. Here's what I'm going to tell you. If she'll try and she'll listen to the coach, she will find it. Made him feel better. Won't that be nice? You see, the program that God calls us to, this program of obedience, this program of looking at life regularly and saying, Lord, what else do I need to rehabilitate in my life? Is it my thought life? Is it my speech life? What is it, Father? Where is it, Lord, that I am breaking these Ten Commandments that I need to better surrender to your Holy Spirit? When we do that, we find that life. How much better when we respect relationships with each other. Not giving false testimony, not lying, not committing adultery, not murdering, not coveting our neighbor's things. How much better when we pay attention to our walk with God. Honoring God. Honoring His Sabbath. Not taking His name in vain. Not putting anything before Him. All of a sudden our connection with God becomes cleaner. Our relationship with one another becomes more loving, healthier. And all of a sudden, there's a lot less chaos. The teenagers call chaos drama, right? Sharon said to the boys the other day, how you doing about the move? We were at the dinner table. And one of them said, can we go already? She said, why? I said, I'm tired of the drama. Tired of the drama? Sharon said, no, wait a minute. You need to understand something. There's going to be drama in your new school. Yeah, I know. It's just going to be different. So they hope it's going to be better. What they also don't get is they're part of the drama. Amen? But when we follow the program, when we are connecting better with the Father, when we're respecting one another, the chaos, the con.
too much of my life was spent living in conflict, and as a result, I can't drink coffee, I can't drink caffeinated tea. I have something called GERD, gastric acid reflux disease. Part of it's hereditary, part of it is I don't deal well with conflict. It chews me up on the inside. Maybe I need to spend a little more time working in programs, deal with my emotions. You know, John Wesley asked his young ordained clergy all the time. Every time he would ordain someone, he would say, "Do you expect to be made perfect in love in this life?" It's Wesley's whole theology of perfection. Do you believe that you can work this program to such an extent that you no longer intentionally sin? The answer he expected from his newly ordained clergy was, "Yes, with God's help, I believe I can do it." See, John always wanted to be in the program, in a process, reaching for a goal. Can you imagine joining Weight Watchers and saying, "My goal is to lose no weight"? Really? "I'm an alcoholic, I'm coming to AA, but I expect to continue to drink." Really? "I'm a heart patient. I'm dying of heart issues. But you know what? I'm not going to stop smoking. I'm not going to stop drinking. I'm eating all the salt that I want and all the high-fat foods. I'm having a pound of bacon every morning." The doctor would say, "Well, that's fine. We'll see you tomorrow in the funeral home." Amen. And yet, isn't that really what we're doing? Father, I want to draw closer to you. I want to be closer with humanity. But I don't want to fix anything, Lord. I don't want to change the way I speak. I don't want to change the way I act. I don't want to change what I do. I kind of like my life this way." Really? So what we're saying to God is, "I want you as Savior. I do not want you as Lord." See, that's not an option. This isn't a pick and choose deal. If he is our Savior, he has to be our Lord. And part of being Lord is following the program. But too often in church, we say, "I'll take the Savior piece. You can keep the Lord piece. I will be in charge." If you're anything like me and you have control issues, that is a tough nut to crack. Getting rid of the big sins, the obvious sins, the sins that most people go about in your life, you've probably figured out how to get away with those. No, that's not true. You've probably forgot how to do away with the other stuff, isn't it? It's the controlling the thought life. It's the surrendering on a daily, moment-by-moment basis to the Heavenly Father. It's respecting boundaries, including days off and taking Sabbath in life. See, Sabbath is, yes, it's about giving your body a chance to rest. It's also about saying, "Father, I'm going to trust you that things are going to be taken care of, even though I'm not at it. I'm going to trust that you're still in control and I don't always have to be working. I'm going to trust you to take care of me." Are we willing to take the program to that level? Are we back at, "I want a Savior but not a Lord"? This season of rehabilitation is about you and I saying like John Wesley's newly ordained clergy, "Yes, I expect to be made perfect. In fact, I expect it so much that I'm working on it every day. Every day I'm saying, Holy Spirit, come and rehabilitate this life. Fix whatever is not pleasing to you, Father, whether it's in our relationship or my relationship with others. Fix it, Lord. Show me where I need some rehab. Send that coach, the Holy Spirit. Send that coach, that brother or sister who I can share with and be held accountable to. Lord, I want to work with. I want to have a whole life." Let's pray. Father God, thank you that you draw us into your presence by your love. You forgive us by your grace. You call us to a life of obedience, and you empower us
by your Holy Spirit. Lord, give us courage to say yes to the program. To strive every day to find in your program